gentlemen, we welcome you all to the 57th Foundation Day celebrations of the National Council of Educational Research and Training, that is the NCERT. As part of today's celebrations, we are honored to have with us Dr. R.S. Praveen, IPS, Secretary, Telangana State Welfare Residential Educational Institution Society, Dr. C.S. Nagaraju, former Principal of RIEM, Dr. S. Sundaraman, Senior Consultant to SSA of Tamil Nadu, and Professor Y. Srikant, Principal of RIEM. Before we proceed to the program, I request our esteemed chief guest to please step forward to light the lamp and invoke the presence of God for the program. Sirs, please, madam, please. Madam, please.
A warm good morning to distinguished members on the stage, invited guests, media personnel, my dear colleagues, and my dear students. I am privileged to welcome Dr. R.S. Praveen Kumar, IPS Secretary, Telangana Social Welfare Residential Educational Institution Society, and chief guest for today's NCERT 57th Foundation Day celebrations. Sir, we are honored with your presence for the occasion. Your wide experience as an administrator in school education will add value to today's panel discussion. We welcome you, sir, for the celebrations. Dr. C.S. Nagaraju, sir, is retired principal of this esteemed institution, RIE Mysore. Sir, you have retired 10 years back. We hear so much about your interest in school education and you are considered as one of the best principals of RIE Mysore that ever had. Sir, we are privileged to hear you. Sir, we are privileged to hear you, especially for those of us who have not met you. Sir, we welcome you for the program. Dr. S. Sundararaman is a man with varied experience in field of education and a senior consultant for Telangana State. Sir, we wholeheartedly welcome you for the 57th NCRT Foundation Day. Professor Y. Srikant, esteemed principal, RIE Mysore, is a person with great vision. Learning outcomes is his brainchild and will be the pathfinder in the field of education for better education system. Sir, we welcome you for the program. I welcome Professor Rama Madam, Dean of Instruction, for the program. I once again welcome all those present for this new concept of panel discussion for students' learning outcomes and systemic accountability. Thank you.
We all gathered here to celebrate the 57th Foundation Day of NCERT. As proud products and stakeholders, I request our principal, Professor Y. Srikant sir, to address the gathering and enlighten us about the Foundation Day of this esteemed organization. Sir, please.
Respected Praveen Kumar, Secretary, TSWREIS Telangana, Professor C.S. Nagaraj, former principal, Sri Sundararaman, senior consultant, Professor Doraswamy, who was also principal of this institute, and my colleagues and students. It's a proud moment for us to celebrate the Foundation Day of NCERT, and we are celebrating the 57th Foundation Day, and NCERT has many achievements in its account over a period of 57 years, and NCERT has produced the curriculum frameworks which have become guideposts for providing direction to the children, teachers, in terms of what needs to be taught in the classrooms. And through this, we have also facilitated the teacher training across the institutions. And also, when it comes to NCERT, it is popularly known throughout the country and even in other parts of the world for its textbooks. We have produced one of the best textbooks in the world, and sometimes people also believe that these textbooks have become so sacrosanct that, you know, they are becoming like Bible. Not only for central level organizations like CBSE and KVs and MVs, but also for the states, they have become guideposts. NCERT is also known for National Talent Search Scheme, which has been implemented right from the beginning, right from its inception, and we are also known for that. The National Talent Search Scheme is one of the prestigious schemes in the country, and in fact I had an opportunity to listen to some of the achievers in the country. And one IAS officer told me, I was successful in IAS but not in NTS. So that's a kind of challenge that, you know, the national talent is providing. The every system has its lacunas, but we need to work on that and work for the betterment of the things. And NCERT is known for All India School Education Survey. We have conducted one of the most comprehensive surveys, a series of surveys through which we have recorded the provisions available in the school system. And that is quite useful not only for the researchers but also for the educational administrators in terms of visualizing for the future what action needs to be taken up and all that. And also that extension activities have been the forte of NCERT, and over a period of time we have worked extensively in providing services to the states in the form of training programs throughout the country. Though we have a limited number of faculty, but through trickle-down effect, we have been able to reach to the school systems largely. And in fact, I must tell you that the National Curriculum Framework, which was formulated about a decade ago, is being realized. Its objectives are being realized right now because it has penetrated down deep into the system and it is creating ripples. And NCERT is also known for research, and some of the institutional researches and otherwise individual researches which have been conducted have been very useful to the system, and they have made it much more effective. And we have 8 constituent units, including the MIE, CAET, PSSIV and 5 RIEs, and they have all been contributing to the improvement of the quality of school education and teacher education. And over a period of time, they have proved themselves to be institutions of repute. And we are in the process of getting the status of INI, and this will also be a proud occasion for us in the coming year. NCERT, as we all know, is an institution which is working very comprehensively in all these areas, and hardly there is any other institution in the world which can match in terms of the impact that it is making, in terms of number of faculty that it has, and the diversity with which we are working. And that does not mean to say that we should not retrospect in terms of what has not been done and what can be done. So we hope to work together, work with the states, and try to improve the situation all across. So that is the reason why the mandate of the Regional Institute of Education is not only simply to elevate the status of the students who are part of this particular college and school, but also to help this region to do the things better. With this hope, I look forward for your cooperation, and I also look forward for the cooperation of the states and UTs in this particular region to do the things better, and collectively we can certainly bring about change. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. As part of today's celebrations, we will be having a panel discussion by these eminent academicians and administrators on students' learning outcomes and systematic accountability. Now, may I request our Dean of Instruction, Professor Rama Madam, to kindly introduce to our audience the panel members for today's panel discussion. Madam, please.
Very good morning to everybody. Happy that is Foundation Day of NCERT. It is my privilege to introduce the panelists. In fact, that I am thankful to NCERT and also RIE Mysore for having identified the most apt persons for this today's that is panel discussion. And every that for since last 2-3 years, that every that is day of the Foundation Day of NCERT, they are identifying some themes, and Aru is also involved in this one. At least I remember 2 years back there was an inclusive education. I was the coordinator. I conducted 1 year workshop for the teachers from like Mysore districts, and like that maybe every year one theme is there. And this time that we have identified the theme, students learning outcomes and systemic accountability. So this is, and also now we have got opportunity to listen from that is administrators and academicians, and because that their perspectives are more important. When I say that is systems accountability, most of the time we make the teachers accountable. We think teachers are responsible, but we are not understanding the teachers are only in the micro system. There is a large macro system. So when everybody come together, and it is possible. And now that we have 4 panelists, they are all having a rich experience. They are both practical field experience and research experience so in the field. So understanding that learning outcome and systemic accountability from their perspectives, and also on the basis of their experience, I think it is a great fortunate for us to have that experience from them. We look forward from all of you, sir. So first I would like to introduce today's that is one of the in that important panelist, that is Dr. Rappalleshiva Praveen Kumar. He is an officer of prestigious Indian Police Service, that in 1995 batch, and he has got very rich experience. I try to just make it as brief as possible. And he is currently working as the Secretary of Telangana Social Welfare and Tribal Welfare Residential Education Institution Society of Government of Telangana, which provide free quality education to thousands of most marginalized children, Dalits and Adivasis. He is the founder member of Swaraj, that is international. So that if I tell briefly about his early life and education, he was born in 1967 in Nalla Malla region of Alampur, that is village Mahabub Nagar, Telangana. So his parents are Srimati Premamma and Sri B.R. Saravana, both served as government teachers in Alampur. Dr. Praveen Kumar completed primary and secondary education in Alampur and Achampet government schools respectively. So that's what most of us that come from the government schools, it is not from the faith. That is one of the great things I would like to acknowledge in this context. He pursued an intermediate from Government Junior College, Kurnool. He obtained Bachelor of Veterinary Science and Master of Veterinary Science degrees and 84-90 and also 1992 respectively from the UNFAL AP Agriculture University, Rajendra Nagar, Hyderabad. Later during his career in the Indian Police Service, he earned a master degree in public administration from the prestigious Kennedy School of Government, Harvard, USA in 2012. Dr. Praveen is one among very few police officers from India who got selected as a fellow for prestigious Edward S. Mazander program in Harvard University. So of course he has achieved many things as a part of his police career, but I would like to mainly concentrate on your contribution to the school system, sir. Transformation of social welfare residential schools. Dr. Praveen Kumar breathed new life into social welfare residential schools by introducing PE model. In this, he added several innovative and path-breaking programs like E-Plus Clubs, Voice for Girls, horse riding, filmmaking, music, dance, water sports, mountaineering, igniter, W-Plus Clubs, Impact, etc. for holistic development of the children. He played an indispensable role in transforming the lives of deprived children, and under his leadership, many students got admission into prestigious IITs, NITs, medical colleges, central universities, law colleges, and CCIP, USA, that etc. Operation, one of his great achievements is Operation of Mount Everest. Dr. Praveen is widely known as the brain behind the success story of the Everest conquerors Malavath Poorna and Anand. Poorna Malavath is the youngest girl in the world to achieve this feat, and Anand Kumar is first Dalit boy to scale Mount Everest. That's why it is, that is network. Dr. Praveen is the guiding force behind launching the payback, that movement called SWAERS. I think I'm pronouncing correctly. Yeah, SWA, that SW means state welfare, ERO means air and sky is the limit. Today all students of social welfare and tribal welfare schools are proud to have the suffix of SWARO to their names, and usage of word Dalit is not encouraged in SWARO's that is ideology. Dr. Praveen introduced 10 commandments and all the SWARO take oath every day to reaffirm their commitment to the observance of the commandments in their lives. Dr. Praveen often exhorts to the underprivileged students, we are not inferior to others and we should not seek sympathy, only sky should be our limit. And yes, and attained and also that, you know, rewarded with many awards. So of course many things are there. I think it is just a brief introduction, keeping in mind the time constraint. So now I'd like to introduce Dr. Professor C.S. Nagaraj, Dr. Chamrajnagar, that is Shankaraya Nagaraju. Date of birth, that is 1945. So your school education, government middle school and municipal high school, Chamrajnagar. So graduation, B.Sc. Yuvaraja's College, Mysore University, and B.H. Sharda Vilas Teachers College. Post graduation, M.Ed. First rank in 1992 and Ph.D. in education in 1979 from Department of Studies in Education, Bangalore University. Obtained M.A. in Rural Social Development from Agriculture Extension and Rural Development Center, Reading University, UK, under the British Council Scholarship in 1980. Started her career as high school teacher after graduation. And then to our surprise that I think he joined the Space Application Center ISRO Ahmedabad as social scientist in satellite community research project. The project dealt with evolving good practices of developing educational TV programs for rural development. So 1976 to 1979. Later he joined NCERT Delhi as professor in 1997, served as head of the then existing Department of Preschool and Elementary Education, Department of Teacher Education, and later in Department of Educational Policy and Perspectives. Held additional charge as coordinator of Educational Resources Innovation Committee, that is ERIC, of NCERT for promoting educational research and innovations through training and budgetary support. In 2006, was posted as the principal of Regional Minister of Education, Mysore, a constituent of that is this one, and retired service from 2007. Sir, as already acknowledged that we all fondly remember your period here, and I know that you encouraged in many persons, and during this period you gave me three main responsibilities of internship coordinator, CEO in charge, and also you made me coordinator for orienting the textbooks which were developed in 2005. So that you are encouraging each and every faculty member in the institute, and you are such a great academician. I think I remember there was a principal who used to come and sit most of the meetings of Department of Education. He was contributing so much. So we always acknowledge your love for knowledge and making others also gain that knowledge. So coming to some other things about Professor Nagaraj, currently have been invited to hold the position of honorary visiting professor at Institute for Socioeconomic Change, Bangalore, and he has done a lot of research work which was sponsored by MHRD, ICSR, and many other this thing. And mainly one of the important things is the MHRD funded project involved implementation of minimum levels of learning in rural schools having two teachers in Karnataka. So many other things were also there. Even after retirement, he is having a very productive life and is involved in various activities. And currently, that he is a consultant to the state level to take up the SERT Meghalaya to benchmark elementary teacher education program. So that he is preparing the report at present. And six students got PhD under his guidance, three from University of Mysore and three from Bangalore. So as now published many research papers and worked as academic editor of Indian Educational Review and Indian Educational Abstract from 2002-2006. And also that he is an academic editor of 6th Survey of Educational Research in India. He served as Government of India representative on 4 joint review missions of DPEP, 2 joint review missions of SSA, member of Appraisal Committee of UPDP project. He served as a member of Committee for Assessing Research Projects to be funded under Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Government of India. So coming to the next person, of course, that he has given just a very brief introduction about this doesn't mean that you don't have anything, sir. You have contributed so much. Whatever is available, I just linked over this one. So there is Sundar Raman, the BSc MA, the DS, Senior Consultant, SSA, SPO, Tamil Nadu. He started the career as a teacher in government high school in 1967, served in the block, district and in state level as academic officer in pedagogy unit and retired in 2006. Have actively involved in several seminars, workshops at national level and taken part in projects namely PECR, DSEP, CAPE and DPEP during 1978 to 84 in different cadet. Actively involved in developing models and suggesting systems for learning assessment during 2007 and 2011. From 2006 till date, working as senior consultant in quality initiatives and pedagogy wing at the state project office and SSA Tamil Nadu. So it is our privilege to have you, sir. So I would like to introduce our the principal professor Y. Srikanth as one of the panel member. Professor Yajnamurthy Srikanth is a postgraduate in geography and education, graduate in law and PhD in geography. He is a professor in education, that is assessment studies at NCRT since 16th September 2013. Prior to this, he served as faculty in Department of Educational Measurement and Evaluation, Curriculum Group and Department of Secondary Education, NCRT. He served as Associate Professor in the Department of Educational Management Information System, National University of Educational Planning and the Administration, NEPA, and as Professor and in charge National Talent Search Scheme at NCRT. That he has got many publications to his credit, so that is a long list. So maybe that I can say that even he has published that his publications were even by Dutch publishers, and he has published in many international journals and the Journal of European Research Network about parents in education, and the building an element accentuating social segregation, and so on and so forth. He acted as reviewer to the professional geographer, a journal of Association of American Geographers. Currently, he is the member of the editorial board of Journal of Educational Issues, Los Angeles, that is United States, Journal of Educational and Developmental Psychology, Canada. His areas of interest are student assessment, education in the public and private sectors, educational quality and accountability. As already introduced, he is a principal with lot of vision. Sir, it is our privilege to have you. So once again, I thank all the panelists. I know that your experiences are really valuable to each and everyone. With this, I just once again welcome you and also thanks for accepting our invitation.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, before we begin with the panel discussion, may I request Dr. Praveen Kumar, sir, to please share his remarks on today's panel discussion. Sir, please.
Thank you. Respected principal of this great institution, Regional Institute of Education, Mysore, Professor Y. Srikanth, the former principal and former principal Dr. C.S. Nagaraju, then Sri Dr. V.S. Sundaranam, senior consultant, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Tamil Nadu, then Professor Rama, the Director of Instructions, and then Professor Padmaja Reddy, who is responsible for me being here, and all the senior faculty members of RIE Mysore, and all the wonderful students of RIE Mysore, and the future teachers and then sculptors of the future of this wonderful country called India. So at the very outset, I congratulate Regional Institute of Education for organizing this 57th Foundation Day of National Council for Education Research and Training. And sir, you have not only produced great books, but this institute, National Council of Education Research Training, has produced thousands and thousands of bureaucrats of this country ever since it was born. Why I am saying this? Because there is no civil services candidate who does not know about National Council of Education Research Training books, NCERT books. So when we started our preparation for civil services, the first thing our mentors told us is to go to a place called Kachiguda in Hyderabad. So there we had a huge long line of candidates standing in front of a shop called Sri Book Square. So this Sri Book Square is known for selling all CBSE books. So that's how we came across NCERT books. So I don't know about the utility of NCERT books about CBSE and all, but for sure I can tell you that thousands and not thousands, lakhs of students in this country like to read the CBSE books, not to know them how it, but to crack the civil services examination. So this is a very interesting experience, that the moment you go to any mentor, sir, I want to prepare for civil services, first thing they would say, go to Sri Book Square, then buy all CBSE books from third class, then try to learn everything again right from scratch. So I thank you, I thank this NCERT for producing wonderful material, and that's the reason why I am here today as a civil servant. So I also congratulate NCERT on this 57th day, because you have produced millions of students in this independent country with a different vision, and then I think every state board of education looks up to CBSE and then NCERT for wonderful material, and this has become a great reference point for designing the curriculum and then making it as pragmatic, as updated as as possible. So I congratulate NCERT for this wonderful effort. Then coming back to the panel discussion, anyway, there will be a panel discussion after my initial remarks, and then I also thank you for giving me this honor of being here as one of the panelists. But before that, most of you might be extremely curious as to why an IPS officer is there in the education department. Are you? Yes. So I joined the Indian Police Service as read by Professor Rama in 1995. So before that I was a veterinarian, and then before that I was just a government school student, and I happen to be son of two government school teachers. So one of the important reasons I joined is very interesting. So I worked in the very serious conflict zones in this country. Maoist zones, we used to call them as Naxalites earlier. Now we call them as Maoists. These are guerrillas in subjects of independent India. So we used to encounter a lot of people. When I say encounter, we used to come across a lot of people in our routine investigations. So there used to be a lot of changes of fire, where we come across rain of bullets, and then we used to fire, and they used to fire, and then a lot of people used to run away, and some people used to surrender, and then so we used to talk to these people who surrender, and then most of them have a very sad tale. Some of them dropped out from the system, and some of them beaten by teachers, some of them particularly the girls, they were not treated well in the schools, and then they were not welcome to the schools, and then parents were not very keen, and they had lot of stories to say, and I used to feel very sad about these people. And then probably had I not been sent to school, and then had I not been taught by teachers who were more responsible in those days, had I not been born to teacher's family, probably I would have been on the other side of the, you know, table. So that would have been a very worst proposition. That's number one. That's number one thing that brought me to this education department. Second thing is my own mother. See, my mother was a bonded laborer in a place called Karnal in 1950s. So when she was going for coolie, coolie means daily wage earner at a very young age, because her parents, her grandparents were bonded laborers in 1930s, so that's what my mom told me at the age of 75. So then two teachers, their names are Prakasham and Purushottam, they were just given the government job as teachers, and then these guys, they go to village and they didn't find any home, so they come to my grandfather's home, and they ask him, look, village, there seems to be no home, so can you please give us at least a space in your hut? So my grandfather was a little smart, and then he said, okay, no problem, you stay here and then pay even 1 rupee as rent, no problem. So then they started saying, and then they saw my mom going as holding a sickle and then going for coolie, and today then after that they convinced my grandfather, and then they made her they ensured that she comes with them to government school every day, maybe walking for about 1.5 to 2 kilometers every day. So that's how my mom completed 7th grade, and then fortunately in those days there were Christian missionary schools, boarding schools particularly. So one of the important sacrifices my mother's mother did was she sacrificed the love and affection and then go from this village. If you come back here, then again people might marry off to someone else, so don't come back. I really salute that grand old lady for her vision, because even today you have child marriages in the villages at the age of 13, 12, 14. So even now in Telangana, as I'm standing here, there could be some child marriages. And we had, just now I got a message, yesterday when I was in airport, I got a message from one of the principal that a 6th grader got married in heart of Hyderabad. So imagine the specter of child marriages. So the girl now, she filed a complaint in the police station and requested the policeman to, protect the identity of the child. So that is a kind of specter that I really salute my great grandmother for sending my mom to boarding schools, and then after that my mom never came back. That's what she says. So she went to Kainul, a place called Kainul, and then she finished her education, and after she went to a place called Yongol. So in those days there used to be a teacher training center run by Britishers. So there she completed a teacher training and then joined the, as teacher. So today my mom is a proud mom of a proud mother of an IPS officer, an associate professor, and a very good doctor. So why am I saying this? Because I think my mom's story can be every girl's story. My mom's story can be every boy's story in the villages. So I thought I should replicate this story. I thought I should replicate this story in every conceivable place. So after 17 years of very tough police service, I have got all possible medals. Don't think that I am not wanted, I was not wanted in police department, that's why I came to this department. No, I got President's Police Medal for gallantry. Gallantry is given to very few poor police officers, maybe there are only 1,000 police officers in this country. There are only 1,000 or maybe 1,500 police officers in this country who got President's Police Medal for gallantry. Not more than that, a country of 10 to 15 lakh policemen. So then I got the President's Police Medal for meritorious service, I got Internal Security Medal, I got United Nations Police Medal, I have the best of possible international exposure and everything. Yet I was not satisfied. I was also the images of those girls and boys who surrender to police. The images of those boys and girls, not girls, boys, who come to police lockups as petty criminals. The people who are dropping out from the system. I am against a word called dropout, because I am in favor of a word called driven out. So but anyway, that's a different argument here. So those images started there, chasing me continuously. Then I had to go to our chief minister, Minister Kiran Kumar Reddy, as the chief minister of Andhra Pradesh. Then I requested him, sir, I am done with police. Now I want to see another experience, and I want to see the system from outside. So then he got confused. For the first time probably in his life, he has seen a police officer who is not asking for a commissioner of police posting, who is not asking for a deputy inspector general of posting. So he said, are you joking, are you serious? No, I am very serious. Then he said, okay, fine, now go. So that's how I am into police, I am into education department. So I, see, this is the last thing I'm going to say. This is my sixth year in education. I wanted to go back to my parent department, but my present chief minister, Sri K. Chandrasekhar Rao, is again very passionate about education. He said, no, you stay put. So that's how I'm here. Now, what I want to tell you as youngsters, before we go for a proper topic in my panel discussion, don't ever underestimate your potential. You can make or break a person. Okay, don't ever, money is not important. Money comes today, tomorrow it goes, and then you can earn money, then you can go for any shopping mall, you can watch any movies, you can have any cool drinks, you can go for any ice cream, all that is fine. But your contribution is going to be extremely important. So it is very, very important, more important than a soldier on the border. More important than a police officer, more important than IS officer. You can shape the lives of thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Just now Rama ma'am was talking about a girl called Malavat Purna. She is the youngest ever female to have scaled Mount Everest. And there is a movie on Malavat Purna's name. The title of the movie is Purna. It was released on 29th of March. So it's a Bollywood movie, proper Bollywood movie. So this girl is from the poorest of the poor background, and to buy one soap, they have to walk for 7 kilometers to go to the nearby town and then buy it, right? And then they didn't have even a proper home. But because of the teachers, the girl joined welfare residential schools, and then today she is the best mountaineer among the girls. She is the best mountaineer, one of the best mountains in among the girls in the world. And then imagine, so what, how many people she has inspired. So as teachers, you should be not only looking into the textbooks, not only looking into these other things, but you should be looking into the touching the lives of people in a real sense. That is what is expected of you from in this thing. So the moment you go, I think most of them will be joining as teachers, right? So our professors or whatever. So my request is, if you are, you are welcome to do other services, but primarily you are being trained in the Indian Institute of Education to become the sculptors of destinies of millions of children. So my request to you is, the moment you join the institution, please don't join unions. There is some time to join unions, but my request is try to explore the world of teaching, and try to explore the world of children, and try to know each and every student. And more than anything else, please start loving the children. We have a slogan in our schools, love or leave. This is what we say, love or leave. If you can't love the children, you can't teach. So this is what the philosophy that is driving us for the last 30 or 40 years. So with these few words, I once again thank you for your patient hearing. And then now, I am not an academician, let me tell you in the beginning itself. So I am only here to, I joined the school education system only to strengthen the hands of teachers and then make a system more efficient, and then try to address the concerns of all stakeholders, because I am also one of the stakeholders. So, but certainly I am not an academician like Sundar Raman sir, or Nagara sir, or Srikant sir, or Rama ma'am. So I am not an academician. So, but I am, for sure, I am here. I like to be, strengthening the hands of all the teachers and all the parents and all the students. So thank you so very much once again for this wonderful opportunity. I wish you all the very best in your careers. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, as we proceed with the panel discussion, may I request Professor Vice Srikant sir, Principal RIUM, to share his views. Sir, please.
There's a slight change in the schedule. I thought that I would set the ball rolling by discussing about this particular issue of students' learning outcomes and systemic accountability. In the morning, I had a long walk with Shri Praveen Kumar, and that was really very enlightening for me. And I saw the passion that he has and that passion is what which makes this nation move. And it is not that, you know, only educationists or people who are in education should carry on the things, but the support that comes from different sources will certainly take us to a different level, sir. And certainly your contribution will be highly recognized, and it will be recognized in future. Professor C.S. Nagaraju, with whom I had an opportunity to work in Delhi, and I've seen how passionate he is also about education and what kind of visionary he is. In fact, he talked about rationalization of school system way back about 10-12 years back, and that is being implemented by some of the states now, in the sense they are planning for closing unviable schools because they have recklessly opened the schools in the name of providing schools at a particular distance, and how far they are feasible, possible and effective, that they never thought of when they opened the schools. So that's how huge money was wasted and closed schools were to be closed. Mr. Sundaraman, I had an opportunity to work both at national level and also in Tamil Nadu. He is part of the SSA, and I've seen how relentlessly he is working even after his retirement. So we have this wonderful panel, and this panel consists of both academic people and administrators, and administrators who are deeply involved in education. So why we have chosen these students' learning outcomes and systemic accountability is that the NCERT has developed a document, the learning outcomes document for classes 1 to 8, and these learning outcomes are part of the RTE, Right to Education Act, and the RTE, as you all know, is the mandate, and it is the right of every child to have access to schooling, and not only schooling but quality schooling that should be provided by the system. And as part of that, learning outcomes have been incorporated, which define the goals to be attained by the students for each class in specific subject areas. So what are the expectations, learning expectations of the children? What are the kinds of processes that need to be undertaken during the class hours and beyond? And what are the outcomes that we are expecting from the students? So all these are defined through learning outcomes, and they have been disseminated across states, translated into different languages, and dissemination workshops have happened in different states. And so when it comes to learning outcomes, we are clear, at least now, that what should be achieved by the students. Then how these learning outcomes will be carried out by the system in order to facilitate the children to realize the goals of what is expected of them is also very important. So in this, the role of stakeholders at different levels is very crucial. So that is how we thought that on this Foundation Day, we can discuss and deliberate on that, and we can, you know, have an extensive interaction, which is very important. When we talk about accountability, I start with systemic accountability, and we all know that systems are accountable. Systems are accountable for the quality education, the reason because huge resources are being pumped into the system. And if system does not improve, then it will be a failure of ourselves to function effectively, and also it is a failure to provide quality education to the future citizens of this country. So we will be failing in our attempt if we don't provide quality school education. So that is how we are responsible, because every taxpayer's money is going into the system and for the quality education that we are talking about. And if that does not happen, then we will be failing. So accountability means giving an account of what we are doing as part of the system, and also it means being answerable. We are answerable as a system. And accountability, as we all know, it is the most advocated and least analyzed notion. We all think that accountability has to be there. But who has to be accountable? Why we should be accountable? How far we should be accountable? So these are some of the questions that, you know, we need to thrash out. And accountability, in a way, it ensures children to reach appropriate levels of quality school education, which are very important, and also to realize their full potential, it is very important that we have accountability. And also, it reduces the dropout rates, rather driven out rates. So, in a sense, that is also very important in order to see how far we are accountable. Are we making students to not to learn and leave the system? So that is how we have to see. And this accountability emanates from the fact that everybody is now talking about standards, quality, excellence, benchmarking, and high-stakes testing. So all these have become part of the educational system because the aspirational levels of the children are growing and aspirational levels of the parents are growing. So as long as we are not accountable to fulfill these aspirational levels, we will fail. When it comes to learning outcomes, like I said, they are now part of the RTE and there are defined and clear expectations of what children should achieve in each class, and they focus not simply on the outputs, rather outcomes are important. Outcomes include outputs but not merely confined to outputs, and these outcomes, along with the outcomes, we also are having curricular expectations and pedagogical processes, which are also very crucial. And in one of the interesting aspects in this is that we have the involvement of teachers, parents and community as part of learning outcomes, because ultimately if quality has to be realized, it has to come from all the quarters, different quarters. And the National Achievement Survey that we are conducting for the first time this year will be aligned to the learning outcomes, in the sense how the learning outcomes have been attained will be monitored through nationwide achievement survey that we are conducting that we are going to conduct. And also that we also believe that the NAS will not provide all the solutions. So we need to have continuous and comprehensive evaluation in order to provide a mechanism through which progress is monitored on a regular basis. And it's also important that we should not say that the learning outcomes are prescriptive. We are not saying that these learning outcomes are prescriptive. They can be modified and contextualized, and they can be used effectively based on their own context. And learning outcomes also provide scope for coming out with clear and measurable outcomes for the children. When we say that these are the learning outcomes, children should understand the relationship of numbers from 1 to 20 in class 1. That means to say that it's not simply remembering the numbers, but it is trying to understand the relationship that exists between different kinds of numbers, from verbal to visual, visual to verbal, and through other modes. And when it comes to the learning outcomes, we are also very clear that we are not focusing on the content, but we are focusing on the competencies that need to be attained. So that is how these are different from earlier, what we called as minimum levels of learning, because in minimum levels of learning, we largely focused on the outcomes rather than the processes and the expectations that the students have and competencies that need to be attained. And these learning outcomes also provide opportunity for exploring and inventing and make meaning out of various aspects related to learning, which is also very important. And when it comes to the learning outcomes and the expectations and accountability, I have taken a reference of a meeting of an association at in USA in 1985. They recommended for licensing examination for new teachers. These are the two recommendations that they have made. This had far-reaching implications for the country like USA. Licensing examination for new teachers, number one. Number two, dismissal of experienced teachers found to be incompetent. I do not know how far this second objective is realized, but certainly licensing examination for new teachers is something which is critical. And even here we have some kind of control through teachers eligibility test, etc. And we know that what is the quality of teachers that we are getting into the system, because roughly about 10 to 15% are only, you know, qualifying a tough examination like TET. The reason, because the teacher training institutions have not really delivered quality products. If that were to be the case, certainly this number would not have been very low. One of the important things that we learned in terms of accountability of stakeholders in attaining the learning outcomes is that we have derived certain models which are otherwise available in management and engineering engineering areas related to these aspects. And the principles that are applied in these kinds of setup are also being looked into education. Certainly, with Mr. Praveen Kumar, I was discussing about this, how to, you know, come out with quantifiable and measurable outcomes through which we can assess the performance of the systems, including that of teachers, is something which is very challenging and that we need to address. When it comes to this, for effective and efficient institutions, we should have clear goals. Clarifying goals is very important, and designing plans for attaining them is something very critical. And thirdly, measuring progress towards them is also important, and diagnosing difficulties in that process is also critical. And redesigning the plan as per the changed activities and requirements is something very critical. So when all these things are implemented in a systematic way, certainly there could be a change. When it comes to applying these principles in our learning outcomes, the National Achievement Survey provides some kind of solutions. Through this National Achievement Survey, we draw systematic sampling, and then we analyze these samples, and based on the performance of the students, we give feedback to the system in terms of how they are improving vis-a-vis others. So now with the present NAS going down to the district level, we have an opportunity to compare the performance of different districts in terms of the performance of academic subject areas of students, such as math, science, social science, languages, etc. So this provides an opportunity for everybody to come out with concrete findings, which are very important. These days, all over the world, people are of the view that you should have evidence-based understanding rather than hypothetical understanding that you have through your own experiences. So this particular NAS provides that kind of evidence-based understanding, which becomes very critical in improving the system. And when we talk about the National Achievement Survey and accountability through some of these systems like NAS, there are always questions with regard to how the standardized testing will facilitate in addressing the needs of the stakeholders, especially the students and teachers. There are some certain issues which we need to talk about. Because the performance in these standardized tests does not mean everything. We need to understand qualitatively in a very contextualized manner at local level as a support mechanism in addition to the National Achievement Surveys in order to understand the grassroots realities. If a student is not performing, there could be various reasons, and the standardized tests will not give answers to all these questions. So that is where the intervention of the teachers comes, and that is how we need to look into that. When it comes to accountability, I must also remind you of the accountability of two types. we talk about systemic accountability and we talk about professional accountability. When it comes to professional accountability, that means to say that as being teachers and as being part of the system, we are accountable for good quality education. When people abdicate their responsibilities, certainly the systemic accountability creeps in. The reason because this kind of accountability, professional accountability, when it is not there, then system ensures that there is some kind of accountability, and that accountability can be visualized through efforts such as National Achievement Survey. National Achievement Survey, why do we conduct National Achievement Survey? Because the quality is considered to be very poor in different parts of the country. So how to improve the quality? To conduct a standardized testing at national level. This may or may not solve the problem, but certainly it gives a kind of understanding which will be very useful to the system. In fact, over a period of time, NAS has provided a big picture of how the system is functioning, especially the teachers and the schools and students. And this has been supported by different surveys. When we conducted the NAS, parallelly the ASSER is also conducting survey, and the findings are almost similar, though they have very unscientific way of conducting the survey, and their survey results do not really suggest for any qualitative improvement in the school education. They highlight and sensationalize what is being done rather than how it is being done and what needs to be improved, etc. So when it comes to accountability, like whether it is systemic accountability or professional accountability, we have to have some accountability in place, and it could be both or it could be either of them. Certainly, if there is no professional accountability, systemic accountability will have an upper hand, and that's how we are right now having things like National Achievement Survey. When we conduct National Achievement Survey and standardized testing, there are certain problems. We cannot set uniform standards. That's why even in the learning outcomes document, we have realized this fact, and we have enunciated that the standards could be different, but the larger framework has to be the same. In the sense, there should be, the children with disadvantaged background and different abilities should have flexible standards rather than rigid standards. This is because uniform standards will not promote social equity, cultural diversity, and appropriate local educational autonomy, which are very critical. But we all know that standards improve curriculum and instructional strategies, and they are very critical. But the system should take into account the fact that standards not supported by resources and standards which are not implemented, modified, and evaluated in order to, as per the requirements, will certainly raise the expectations without providing adequate and appropriate results. So standards are important, but at the same time, resources necessary in order to realize these standards are equally important. When it comes to resource support, critical, and the system has to provide, and we have largely this system in place. But at the same time, we should also have early warning systems in order to control the damage that can happen at a later stages. If a class 3 child is not performing, if we have early warning system, that is, if we can provide the feedback to the student at an early stage, then it will facilitate that child to improve, and rather than providing at a later stage and then saying that a class 8 child is not able to learn even to the level of class 5. Because too much of damage is already done and you cannot recuperate. So these are some of the problems. And And we should also consider that education is a field which requires a long-term support. It is not that, you know, something happens overnight like in any other field. It is not in production mode that we can think of in terms of education, and that is very critical. And also critical is the fact that holistic educational data gathering, and I was also discussing the same with Sri Praveen Kumar in the morning, that when it comes to data, we are very poor in database management. We produce data for the sake of data and not utilize, which is a crime. The reason, because so much of human and financial resources are wasted when we don't use the data and produce the data. So that's very important. And finally, I would also like to highlight the fact that when it comes to standardized testing or CCE, there are certain aspects which can be monitored through effective means and measures, but ultimately there are certain things for which we need to empower the teachers, and we need to support the teachers, and we need to have good leaders who can carry forward the message of providing quality education, and that can happen at much more decentralized levels, and that can happen by empowering our teacher leaders, that is institutional heads and teachers. So with this I conclude, and largely I feel that systems are accountable, and they should be made accountable. There are certain ways through which we can make the systems accountable for the learning outcomes of the children, but there are certainly gray areas on which we need to work. So this is how I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now may I request Dr. R.S. Praveen Kumar, sir, to please share your views. So please.
Thank you, Professor Srikant, for wonderful observations and then very insightful. See, yesterday, a couple of days ago, when I got a call from RIU Mysore about elementary education and the learning outcomes, although we had a rough idea about what happens in elementary education and then what kind of outcomes are expected and then what kind of accountability systems can be put in place. And Nagaraj sir, Professor Srikant sir has rightly pointed out about the professional accountability and then systemic accountability. So I was talking to one of the block education officers in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. We don't call it as block, we call it as mandals. So I was talking to one of the mandal education officers, and then I was wondering to know whether the system has improved or the system has at the same status quo or the system has deteriorated. So some of the important observations that I have come across are, one is people are confused about different boards of different boards and different streams of education. So you have Anganwadi in government sector. So you have pre-primary, then convents, and then play schools mushrooming in the rural areas. Then you have government primary schools, and then you have upper primary schools, and then you have high schools, then you have colleges. Then second thing that Tina told me is the enrollment in private schools in most of the rural areas is growing because the people who are well-to-do in the villages are sending their children to private schools primarily because of medium of instruction. So since medium of instruction is English, so they are sending their children to private schools, and then more like well-to-do, when I say like whose average income is say about 500 to 1000 rupees, 500 rupees per day, let's say. So within the government schools, like for example in Telangana, we have 61.75 lakh children from K to 12, and out of 61.75 lakhs, we have only 31 to 32 lakhs studying in private schools and remaining 29 lakhs are studying in government schools. The enrollment into government schools is, as of now, looks dipping slowly, not steadily but slowly. Then that is one thing that he told me, and then we also discovered through the school education department's statistics. Then third thing what he had told me, the attendance. Attendance is, today child A comes into school, tomorrow he goes absent, and then tomorrow child B doesn't come, and then child C. So the attendance is again is a big challenge in elementary education. Then the third is attendance of teachers itself is a challenge. So at any given point of time in any district, what he said was 25% of the teachers are perpetually absent in one or other school. There is something called French leave. So French leave is like you give a leave letter and you put it on principal's table and headmaster's table, and then when you go, then he is on leave. If you don't go, then he is on duty. So this is something very interesting that he also told, and then I have also discovered in some of the schools. So I'm only talking about the administrative, like how we look at the system. There may be some genuine problems. Now to fill up the gaps in the strength of teachers, government has come up with a system called Vidya Volunteers. So Vidya Volunteers in primary education, and then most of the regular teachers, they have smarted the system. They have they have mastered the system, and then they started handing over the entire job of teaching to Vidya Volunteers, at least in 25 to 30% of the schools, and then these people will be doing something else, and the Vidya Volunteers will be slogging on the field, like whatnot, so everything. So this is one thing that he also finding very difficult. Now unions, when you talk about accountability, you cannot ignore unions. So unions, whenever they come to any administrator or any head of the department, they would come with every demand, be it surrender leave, be it increasing, be it TA, be it posting, be it transfer and counseling policy, but not improving the outcomes. I have seen all the demands of our teacher colleagues. Sir, spouse case, please consider transfer of X, Y, Z, because both of them are teachers, so you have to put them together. There are 100 zeros which are there in the dairy. And every union member comes with a dairy of big dairy, and half of it will be all the government zeros. All government zeros. And it is common in every state. I'm not exaggerating what I have seen. So then you go to any union address or any meeting, they will discuss about everything but not the improving the quality and learning outcomes in the schools. So this is the reality. Now there is no point in scapegoating XYZ, or there is no point in being skeptical, because India is a growing country. India is aspiring to be a global superpower, and then we as educated Indians at this point of 21st century, we cannot ignore the aspirations of poorest of the poor people, and we cannot sit idle. So what I have in my mind, I would like to, they might look very naive, but I thought I should put forth before this August gathering, is can we have the licensing of teachers, as rightly echoed by Professor Y. Srikanth. So I think India, if it has to have a better teacher quality, we must seriously start thinking about licensing of teachers, which will at least, but anyway, the process has to be absolutely objective, like GRE, like TOEFL, and like MPSC, like many other entrance examinations in Uganda, like IIT mains and the JE mains and the JE advanced. Can we go for teacher licensing procedure? Is something which is very important. Like you have doctor licensing procedures, and you have a lot of other procedures in the same country. So can we go for that? Is something which I want you to think about. Then second thing is, as someone has pointed out in the beginning itself, that Ramamayam has told us that the teacher is not everything. I fully agree. The impact of teacher on any student is only 25%. then the remaining 75% constitutes comprises of the peer groups, the parents, the larger community, and the other elements of ecosystem. So why are we again and again pointing on teachers alone for decreasing the outcomes is something which we must seriously look into. So we should not scapegoat teachers for the fault which they are not responsible for. We should not make them unnecessarily guilty for the things that for the crime that they have not committed at all. So then in that case, who should be accountable? I think parents should be accountable, because parents in this current generation have conveniently outsourced the art of parenting to teachers. Do you agree with me? So most of the teachers, most of the parents, they don't want to raise the child. They want to outsource it to the schools. And I'm seeing it with my own eyes in residential schools. We have 3 lakh students currently in our residential schools. They are parents, they are mentors, they are philosophers, and whenever we call parents for parent-teacher meeting, they hardly come. Even if they come, they come in drunken state. Or they send one of the representatives from their neighborhood, go and then look at our children, come back and give a debriefing report. We also, we don't want to go because we have a lot of serials to watch, we have a lot of festivals to celebrate, so on and so forth. So I think the accountability from parents side also has to be seriously demanded. So as an extension of this idea, can we have a school of parenting? Like you have National Council of Teachers Education. If you have a regional institute of education which trains teachers, can we have National Council for Parent Education? Can we have a course like you have B.Ed.? Can we have certificate courses for parenting? Can we tell people, look, you marry only when you are eligible? Why not? Think about it. Because today you have so many rural youth are just getting infatuated, getting, you know, carried away by the movies and then eloping with someone, and then finally the disaster. So now the issue here is, now I want this nation and I want these institutes to think about parenting education as a very serious activity. Because they are the people who are going to influence a lot of decision making till you cross your teenage. In that case, why is it we are not training them is something that I want you to, you know, think about. Then third is, we are also experimenting with a concept called co-schooling. We don't want to call it a homeschooling, because homeschooling, we are not in a stage where we can go for a total homeschooling. It is not possible, because when we have people without homes, then there is no point in calling about homeschooling. And when they go to, there is no privacy in homes, there is no shelter, there is no roof, and the people are sleeping in the shelters. So I don't want to talk about that. But co-schooling to some extent can be outsourced to community. That would reduce the burden on teacher. So can teacher teach the, instead of students, in addition to students, can we teach as to how to introduce the concept of elementary education into the communities is something which we have to look into. So like you have in churches, you have Sunday school. In Sunday school, what they do, they teach about parables in the Bible. And then every child would love to go to, you know, church. Then when a child comes into class, then he or she must come with some basic knowledge about what is being taught. I call it as pre-reading, and then let me also call it as co-schooling. So in co-schooling, parents also are the active participant. The community itself is active participant of education. So this is a systemic accountability aspect of it. So my request to RIE is to, you know, seriously consider that. Now we are experimenting with something called pre-reading in our classrooms. Now, pre-reading, initially there was a lot of opposition, because most of the teachers said, sir, if a child comes to classroom after having read a lot of chapters, then what is that I have to teach? Then how will he or she look at me when I start teaching? If I go wrong, then how will the power equation be in the classroom? So, but we still wanted to go ahead, because pre-reading is very important. We didn't want the students to be passive listeners
like what you are doing now. So I think passive listening is, like, I don't know whether we listen and they learn anything from long listening. So there must be some scope for activity. So I think you are the masters of this game, so I don't want to talk about this, a slippery slope for me. But what I'm trying to tell is, I think we must encourage the children to come with some pre-reading. And we must make those resources available. If we are so poor that we are not in a position to give the resources, and let the experience of the community be a resource. Let the experience of the child be a resource, and then let him or her jot down something and then come to the classroom so that there can be an active discussion in the classroom. And that becomes another very important accountability mechanism in the school. And there was an idea, I don't know, like when you visit, when you go to any restaurant, before you go to restaurant, now you have something called Zomato. You know, I don't know how many of you are available, Food Panda, Zomato, and then a lot of other apps you have. So the moment you start moving, then you have a Google Map, suddenly the restaurant names pop up, then you go to the restaurant website, then suddenly you see the star ratings. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so you have a lot of, so you want to watch a movie, so you go to bookmyshow.com and then you see what is the star rating this movie has got. Can we introduce benchmarking of the schools by giving due ratings? I've been very cautious here because morning when I was walking with you also told you, you must see the context from which the children come from. You must see the context from which the students and teachers come from. So given that they are coming from different context, we can work out a weightage, and then still we can rate the schools. And we can rate the school as a system instead of rating each and every teacher might be a too far-fetched dream in a country like India. At least rate the schools and give the resources to schools, so that school there is the collective responsibility and then systemic accountability in doing a bookmyschool.com. If some of you can start a website called bookmyschool.com, then everybody would open his own or her own. Already there is a Facebook, but our people are busy in pasting the photographs of their puppies rather than their institutions. So what I'm trying to tell you is, like, can we start a systemic accountability of bookmyschool.com? Is something which might work, because now the amount of the kind of the pace with which smartphones are entering into our bedrooms is unimaginably high. So you go from Karnataka to from Bangalore to Mysore, I was coming last night, and on the right side and left side of the road, only Deepika Padukone's photograph is there with Oppo and Vivo. So now this is the kind of invasion of smartphone technologies. Can we do something on this? An idea which can be leveraged, if you can leverage the present technology to improve the systemic accountability is very important. But lastly, see, one thing is, you are talking about ACER report, but even if ACER report is wrong, but there must be something, at least 50% or 25% of it might be right. So we as administrator, I don't want to push the teachers to give me 100% result. So now there is a rush to produce 100% result, and that is causing a lot of burden in teachers. And then 50% of the teachers, they are going for shortcuts. That's the reason why in 10th grade you see 100% result, in plus 2 you see only 75% result, and when you go to universities, the pass percentage is abysmally low, maybe around 30-35%. So then where is this remaining 65% going? Where are they going? Are they becoming auto drivers? Are they becoming young mothers? Or are they becoming coolies? Then where are these people going? So it is something which needs to be worked out. And administration also, from my side, I would say, we should be really patient when it comes to this thing. I mean, we should have a 360 degrees kind of view when we demand accountability from the teachers. And then lastly, sir, with all humility, I would like to request you. I was going through the NCERT learning outcomes book, which Sundaraman sir is having. So, sir, it looks very complex for the young generation. Now, young generation are so used to WhatsApp messages, are so used to short messages. Their attention on any content that is thrown at them is very less. It is, I would say, very small, very ephemeral. So when we design the content, it should be like WhatsApp. That's what I was trying to share in the night when we were having dinner. So nowhere it is written that please use WhatsApp. But how many of you have WhatsApp?
I think all of you must be having WhatsApp. So nobody has forced you to download WhatsApp app in your phones. You have done it on your own because it's so simple, it is so exciting, then it is so secure. Everything you communicate with others is encrypted, 16-point encryption. And it is very easy, and it operates with every operating system, iOS, then Android, then Symbian, then BlackBerry, whatnot, everything. So this is very important when we design outcomes, and then when we design something for teachers. Teachers are also human beings, and they also have the same attention span. So we need to really simplify the content, and then make it more appealing, make it more palatable, and make it more replicable in the system. Is something which we need to really work on. And then the challenge is for the youngsters. The older generation, they are used to write longer texts, but younger generation, now you must see that you create a kind of WhatsApp kind of moment in education arena. So I think this is another very important element of self perpetuating systemic accountability. If any innovation in accountability domain, if it is not self perpetuating, if it is not sustainable, I don't think it will live for a longer time. So thank you so very much for your time. Once again, I thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now may I request Dr. C.S. Nagaraju, sir, former principal at IUM, to please share his views. Sir, please.
My colleagues and students, I want to look to the issues today as a person standing outside from the education system, at the same time as a forum of critique of the developments that have taken place in the elementary education field, at least. When I got this invitation, the title of the symposium was Students, a Philosophy as Learning Outcomes and Systemic Accountability. When I see the apostrophe is missing. So the students are separate, learning outcomes are separate, and accountability is separate. From my point of view, Right to Education Act emerges out of Right to Life, which we all know. Education becomes an essential feature of survival, in whatever the way in which you interpret Right to Life. That means the apostrophe should be in singular. Students, singular, learning outcomes. That is what. And secondly, the Right to Education Act also talks about right for equality of educational opportunity for comparable learning outcomes. So what is the learning outcome? Is that what every child learns against a benchmark expectation, possibly based upon deliberation and discussion and consultation, to ensure child to survive in the coming world. So what is this is a kind of issue that we are trying to evolve over a period of time. NCERT has come out with some set of learning competences and learning outcomes to be achieved. It is not yet achieved in the context, and we can go on discussing that. Now, the next question I asked myself is, what factors affect learning outcomes? Of course, the obvious base foundational is students' aptitudes. That means students each of the child, each and every child comes with certain learning background, which is already acknowledged in the NCERT's learning outcome document, and we have to look upon this as a given and then try to build upon that. This is every child. The second thing is, once we talk about students' aptitude and the given level of the child, every child requires certain time to learn the learning competencies or whatever that you are talking about, objectives or goals, etc. They require certain time. If I were to start learning violin, I require more time because I am completely ignorant. But there may be other child, other person who has got some basic knowledge of notes and other kinds of coordination, etc. Probably they learn quickly. That means individualized learning is very important in ensuring comparable quality. The another aspect is, if I have to do this as a teacher, I must have certain competence to manage individualized learning. And if the teachers are skillful enough to provide the required time on task to every child to master the competency, to master the learning task, then only it is possible to make all children learn the required competency. And the fourth factor is the arranging the context to ensure opportunity time. Opportunity time is require different kinds of management of time of each child. So to some extent, I have seen an effort of this kind of thing in Tamil Nadu element primary schools in the form of learning ladders and other support materials, etc. But still, it has to operate in a given historical context. But this learning system, that as the factors of learning organization system, is very important to facilitate the teacher's management competence to ensure every child reach the comparable quality of education. Now, in order to, because most of us, we are talking about evaluation accountability. Now, if I have to look at this, even though our national surveys, VASER, etc., they talk about achievement, they collect data at the individual level, aggregate children across various categories like urban, rural, government, private. But nowhere I have seen the evaluation quantifying educational levels at the school level. Because if I have to make system accountable, school is the unit of comparison, not children. Is it possible for us to evolve indicators of school performance, then compare school categories and look at the available or lacking aspects of systemic aspects like teachers, like rooms, like curriculum. These aspects, suppose I would like to relate with the school's performance, then it is possible for me to provide basis for accountability at the systemic level. When we talk about child dropout, we are only talking about child dropping out of school. nobody is concerned or nobody is aware that the child is dropping out of a system. So I think we need to look at this issue of systemic responses to what is happening in the educational context. I want to go further because I worked in the context of 1992 minimum levels of learning, which was introduced at the National Policy of Education as a plan of action, and I wanted to find out what are the issues that are there in implementing the minimum levels of learning in two teacher schools in Karnataka. So this, I worked for 3 years with a starting point of about 10% of school in the entire district, and then selected low performing two teacher schools, about 60-65, worked with them 1 year to understand the situation and develop intervention packages, etc., then trying to orient teachers and then implementing this. And I can say that my effort showed some kind of improvement from starting from 8-12% in the case of first and second standard achievement. Third and fourth standard achievement, there was no significant difference before and after at the school level. I'm talking about school as the unit of comparison. And then the teacher said, "Sir, when we started, you started at third and fourth standard because those first and second standard children have not learnt their basic things, therefore we cannot do anything. That means if I have to start, I realized that it has to go hierarchically from first standard onwards." And then I found that the issue that I addressed was, how do I improve by making multi-level teaching the opportunity time given to the child, second opportunity, and in the way in which the teachers have to adapt the curriculum. Now, but later on, I realized that wherever I go, all over the country, every teacher says, "Sir, you give us 4 teachers, we will also show the same result as the urban schools." And our curriculum also talks about class 1 competency, class 2 competency. We expect that there will be a teacher for one topic or one subject teaching in one, at a particular point of time, to a homogeneous group of children of same age in a ladder way, first standard, second standard, third standard. But if I have to take the example of Karnataka, almost 81% of the schools don't have this matching of one teacher, one class in the primary school, elementary schools, not only primary, elementary. And almost all the schools have this multi-grade situation. Then if I have to ensure the opportunity time for these children, I need to look as the concept of a viable school. A viable school is that which has got around 500-600 children with 8 standards or 1-5 standard depending upon this. And then every class has got a teacher, and also there will be specialization of teachers to teach English. We expect all teachers to teach English. We expect all teachers to teach mathematics. But if I were to look into your own DMS school, I were looking to a private school where my child goes, then always an English teacher, a mathematics teacher, a science teacher teaching different classes, but their specialization. That means always at one point of time, one teacher is teaching one topic, one subject. That actually allows the child to, of course, with what is known as curricular adaptations, participation, project method, constructivism, all these things can come into play if there is an opportunity for teacher mediated learning in the school, in the classrooms, and now I'm talking about school outcomes. Learning outcome is a general one, but actually we are talking about accountability of school for school learning. How it can be done, this is what Professor I. Srikant was referring to when I gave this lecture. I cannot change the mindset of teachers who are trained in traditional industrial oriented, production oriented teacher training program, where they are always taught, where they are trying to teach one class of one topic in at a particular point of time. But the most of the teaching learning conditions in the real context is a different thing as compared to the training context. Even under various kinds of SSP, SSA and DPEP, teachers are trained without any student in front of them as teacher training program. I think Sundar Raman may account, tell me for that. They will take, they are taken out, then kept in a diet, and then people are taught about, and sometimes teachers themselves have to play the role of students, which is not the same as on-site hands-on training program for developing competencies. Therefore, we have to look into why this has happened over a period of time, when majority of the students who are working in public schools, that is public funded schools, I'm not talking about public schools of Delhi or Bangalore, I'm talking about public funded schools, that they are deprived of opportunity, time to learn the expected competencies. Somebody is talking about resources. In fact, for the current level of our performance, we are actually using more than required resources. We don't require 22 teachers teaching in 10 schools of a panchayat. If I can make these schools bring these children together within the panchayat in two places, bring children of upper primary school to one place in one panchayat, I can have three schools, all these 22 teachers can be accommodated with two or three teachers per. But panchayats are not in the picture of educational planning. They are only co-opted to do our menial work. We tell them, when you dig a hole there, then they have to dig the hole. But not to decide what kind of school, where they want to do this one, and how they have to manage. So this viable school concept, at present, because many of these norms, etc., have come out in 1980s, when the connectivity of habitations was less. But still there are social issues, social problems. Government doesn't want to start a neighborhood school because of various caste equations in many places in North India, or even in this one. Because I have gone to apprise the educational planning in the name of putting a school within the habitation, we have broken the existing school into 2-3 schools. Separate school for this habitation means separate schools for this scheduled caste. Separate schools for that habitation means separate schools for these cohorts. But we have increased the number of schools with 2 teachers, 3 teachers over a period of. No school has come with complete complement of teachers during the expansion of elementary education, primary school education, from 90 onwards. All the new schools that have been started are 2 teachers, 2 room schools. Why is that? I think this is an issue, a challenge that needs to be focused, and there needs to be an advocacy of decentralized educational management, giving the onus of providing better education for our children in a panchayat area, not leaving that to an outside BEO or outside Secretary of Education, then compelling education system at the higher level to provide them academic support, to provide them monetary support, which is a commitment and as a part of constitution of this one. So this advocacy of, I know many objections will be there, the schools may be, but now in different panchayats may not work inequally, but now the mistakes of a district or a state is affecting all the children of the state. It may be problems may create in one or two panchayats or one or two mandals, one or two districts, but at least the other people who are responsible would like to see that their children get better education. Once the government schools become viable, this mushrooming of private school can be contained. When my school can afford a competent elementary, a competent English teacher to teach my students, then parents will send their children to my school. So these are certain issues which actually affect the power structure that are operating, political and economic power structure that are operating in the field of education. Instead of industrial model of education production, we need to take the agricultural model. Because agriculture, every farmer is concerned with their field, every farmer needs to be what is known as supported, helped. Every farmer's soil has to be tested. That means it's a kind of micro level educational management and planning which is required to make system accountable. Otherwise, we will have these disparities of educational system, private, public, government, what is two teacher, five teacher, 10 teacher schools, and then also the hierarchy of schooling, CBSE, ICSE, and now they are this, that, etc. And why is that? We have caste system, we have caste system of education. But we are going to work towards democracy means we need to break at the educational systemic level this caste system. If it can be done, that is the probably the challenge that we need to address as institutions of national importance. We have not bothered or built in the importance of opportunity time in our calculations and factoring antecedents for low levels of achievement which are thrown out by NCERT surveys, ASSER reports, etc. And we can go on talking on how it drawn issues, etc. This is what I would like to present at this point of time, that there must be rethinking of educational planning, rethinking of looking at the way in which schools are managed, and understanding and committing that every child should exhibit comparable quality of school learning. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now may I request Shri Sundarraman sir, senior consultant, SSA Tamil Nadu, to please share his views. Sir, please.
I think good afternoon to everybody. I say good afternoon because almost we are nearing 12 o'clock. At this juncture, I want to cite a small thing. As we have been discussing from 9:45 onwards, now it is 11:45. So 2 hours in excellent planning at national level, in all level implementation, everything largely saw as said in the classroom process. Now that it is a time for our tea. your people are all seeing the face. When we will have some time to go out and come back, now that the classroom comes, the actual field reality comes here. I want to cite. I give it, no, anyhow, I have just for fun sake I said that, but anyhow I come to the like. I give you a small, what I experienced. Number one, a student of 8th standard, that grandchild of my teacher in Chennai, that is number two. Last week I met him. Gratitude sake, I just we had a talk with my teacher. He is 90 years old. The boy, when he was doing something, studying 8th standard in a meritorious school, he came, Tata, I don't want to continue any more studies. Till 8th standard, I have been going to school for the last 10 years, starting from pre-KG, LKG, UKG, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8. I got an excellent computer, laptop, all facilities I have. Whatever you want, I can get it within a minute. I go to a shop, anything I can buy. Whatever you want, I can get it from my net. I can go to a shop, get things. I can read any book. I can get anything. Anyone want me to go to school anymore? This is the question posed by a child of 8th standard. How we have to make him to realize that he has to pursue his studies in school, colleges, and how long? You please think, every one of us. My teacher and myself were shocked at that moment. We did not expect, both of us. Today is the status of children in our, in almost all the states. The boy has come out with his saying. Then school, what it should do? What the school should provide to the child? How the classroom should be there? It's a very great question. Now that, after hearing for 1.5 years all these things, all this information that you have provided the great eminent, I admire their services and their experiences, the field work that they have done. My experience is, the child of second standard, when it enters into the third, unless the child is able to read, write the mother tongue without any mistake, the child will not continue or pursue its studies even if the child sits in the class. Now that you please think, I attend so many seminars, workshops in Delhi. Basically, I do not know Hindi. But I can, after a long time, 40 to 50 years, 50, I do have some connection with the department of NCERT and all other institutions. So I am going and coming, sitting and hearing the language. I am able to understand what they speak. At times, when English mixed Hindi is coming, very easily I will understand. When English alone is there, I will easily understand. When Hindi alone is there, I was just thinking like that. So the children of third and fourth standard are chilling by that when they are not able to read in the classroom. Their mother tongue itself, that's the main problem. So I wholeheartedly appreciate the NCERT's effort of bringing early literacy program. Make the child in government schools or private, in the government aided private schools, the child of second standard, when it enters to third, should be able to read and write its mother tongue. It should be concentrated. It is there. It has started some 3 years back. It should be given momentum. That's my state. Number two is, the classroom process with regard to that, only 3 points I will touch. The classroom process, I cite an example. We are standing in the platform. We are standing in the platform of a railway station. The train moves fast. There is an indication of the name of the train, Chennai Express, Kerala Express, Mysore Express, something like that. When the train passes very fastly, can we read the name post, name indication in the compartment? Can we? The There is a name board in the outside of the compartment train. There are 18 compartments or 20 compartments. It goes very fast. I am standing on the platform. The train is not stopping. I want to know which train is it. Not stopping in my station where I am standing. I cannot. Well, in Santa standard, if this is happened to be a small classroom or the teachers or something, I can give many questions and then discuss. Now that it is a higher platform, so I come very close. In the classroom science textbook, there is a topic in the name of Newton color disc. There are 7 colors are made in the round and it is connected with a small platform. We just, if you till it, the color disc will move very fast. If you see it, you cannot see the different colors. When it is moving very fast, when it slowly comes down, you can see all the 7 colors. When this being taught in the classroom, if we take the actual full reality of what is happening here, is there any connection between the color in the disc and my seeing with my eyes? The connection between us. When can I see an object clearly? What is the time of my retina to have that light from the part to see it clearly? Is to be linked here. Unless the teacher does it, the child may not link it with what is being on the platform. Is it happening in the classroom? Now that the as Sari has said, the linkage between the pedagogical process, the expected learning outcome is the child should live in the society by taking something in the classroom process to fit in the society, to link what the child has learnt in the classroom. Unless the teacher, in every class, the need for the child to use what is learnt in the classroom in the society, we cannot make any accountability anywhere in the classroom or outside. So the teacher should have enough knowledge, enough, as Mr. Abdul Kalam sir has said, every day the teacher should read. Yesterday we conducted a workshop for teachers on this topic. And some of the workshops at the district level, they were asking, they have formed a group, 5 or 6 or 8 or 10, and they give the curricular expectation, that is the expected learning outcome of the children on this topic, and also linkage in the classroom, how it could be linked in the classroom. They are developing a particular structure, how this should be taken to the classroom, focusing on the learning outcome. The group, what does always the group, what does the group do? Two will be sitting and two will be doing and the two will be addressing. That should move. So what I, from my experience, did, there are 45 participants. I made, including teachers, block teacher educators and officials were also there. They are all teachers basically. I asked everybody to prepare one format or linking all these things to make this competency, take this competency into the classroom. After 1.5 hours, we are giving the information, we ask them to do it for one whole day. Everybody was stunned. Sir, for one competency, linking all these things to take it to the classroom, it takes whole day for me. For experiencing in the classroom several competencies the whole year for all the students. How long we have to prepare to make the student fit to be come out from that class? Now we understand. For the last 3 decades, teachers said, for the last 3 decades, what we have done is, we have developed curriculum, we have developed textbooks, syllabus and textbooks. We made textbook itself as a workbook. We made the children to write on the workbook. And we have made the teachers to feel that the textbook alone is a Veda Mantra. It is only enough. The textbook, if I impart to the children, that is enough. As I told you beginning, in the platforms, standing there, how we have to see that all this linkage and time to think to link has come out short. So when we, how can we think in that way? Another one. We, the government servants, have got more freedom also. We plan for latest Aspirati Act, the syllabus, as in continuation of the curriculum, we frame for 200 days, primary or upper primary. You work out if it is the 200 hours, that means for a full year. The teacher, what is the concession we give to the teacher? 15 days leave, medical leave, year leave, they are taking all these things. Classroom, everything is there. We provide, we give. We must think, the state or the central government should think how to help the students not wasting even a minute in the classroom. Not a single period. The teacher takes leave, other man should come in and substitute that classroom for the benefit of the children. We can help the teacher since he happens to be a government servant. He cannot avoid giving his concession. At the same time, students' opportunity time is not there. Here, when our sir, previous principals are told about something with regard to the teacher's accountability, there, the classroom teacher accountability comes when the opportunity time comes. Only 20 minutes of the 1 hour, if the classroom is for 60 minutes, 20% of the time alone, teacher should take. All the other time, the students should think and act. Nowadays, in almost all the classrooms in all the state, I visited large number of schools in Karnataka also, large number of schools in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and almost 17 to 18 states I have seen several schools. For several days, I have put in nearly 50 years of service now, continuously from my starting service in 67. So all the classrooms are almost same. So the teacher opportunity time should be only 20%. The student opportunity time should be more. The student may be asked to say, thinking in that only the ABL system has come in Tamil Nadu. To certain extent it is coming, but there you go, we have constraints in that also. As per the legally here it is what is happening. So when I want to express my thought about the classroom process, accountability, systematic accountability, the conducive atmosphere in the classroom for the teacher, the conducive atmosphere provision of all the facilities in the classroom, the conducive atmosphere for learning situation in the classroom, linking the curriculum, the expected learning outcome, and the assessment system should go together. Now that I feel happy towards the fact end of my period of service, I can say, because I have put in 50 years and 70 years at any time and come out of the system. I am happy with this time that some momentum has been taken, some initiative has taken in the central and the state level to link all these things and provide support to the teachers and to improve the status. A large level of thinking has come in all field to improve the classroom process. Definitely, if the state and the central jointly, we may say in some states closely they are working, in some states isolatedly it is there. In some of the projects, or may say in SSA, the two programs coming to the same class, almost 6 to 8 in some of the states, are differently working. All these things are being interlinked presently, the initiative has come. So when the initiative comes with success, definitely we will yield some good results, and the systemic accountability will give us a very large improvement, and we can see wonderful children in future from our state. As I take 1 minute and complete. As sir said some 10 years back, with some of my colleagues, we had been to a district wherein we were made to meet some of the discuss with some of the convicts in the jail. Most of them were 25 to 35 years. Small theft they have come to the jail. Small theft they have come. Once they go into the police department, when they come out, the society is not accepting. So we are asked to discuss with them regarding what made them to do such mistakes. We find out what made them. When I discuss large number of people there, they are saying it's only 2 points. One, we have not been explained what is right, what is wrong in my young age in the classroom. First to fifth standard or sixth standard. What I do is right, I was thinking. When I get some help to the house, my parents were also telling that it is not a wrong thing. They are not explained. Even the school authorities also. My teachers also. And they know they have left it as it is. If they would have been informed in the beginning itself, I would have understood something and would not have committed. Now that I feel, I am not accepted by the society of going and coming out to the police. So that is also a problem. We have given some information regarding that. And they are also taking much care to help them to become a good citizen after being punished for a certain period. The things are also there. Personally, I wonder how our Praveen Kumar sir is able to concentrate on educational field being in other department. In Andhra, some 10 years back when I had been there, I was hesitating to hear the assistant project officer of SSA in Kerala, in Andhra Pradesh, was not from educational field. Almost in all the districts, they were from social welfare department, agriculture department, industry department. There was a question in the entire state, in the nation, in all the states, why the educational authorities are not leading and working as an assistant project officer. I too asked. And since I come across the people having much involvement in the educational field like our Praveen Kumar, why can't those people expertise in education do more social service to the people? I wonder, I was very happy on that. So with this, I got more information to discuss on certain things. Since it becomes 12 o'clock, if time permits, we'll have less. I conclude with this. I feel happy to be here. And I can openly say that I am representing my SPD, sir. I think the whole of my service, an individual in any government sector can assist his higher officer, can represent his officer, should never substitute him. So, representing is a great honor made to me. I am being proud to be with you all. Among all the time I have come here for the class, some 20 years, now that today I feel proud to be with you all people. May God bless us, bless all of us to come do more service. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. As our panel discussion comes to an end, I thank everyone for enlightening us on the topic. Now, may I request our principal, sir, Professor Vaish Shrikant, to please present the mementos for our guests. Thank you.
To Dr. C.S. Nagaraju, sir. To Sri S. Sundararaman, sir. Now may I request our Dean of Instruction, Dr. Rama Madam, to please present the memento to our principal. Thank you, madam. Thank you, sirs. Now, I request all the audience and the guests and the guests to please break for tea. And we'll start the cultural extravaganza in 10 minutes. So please join us for the cultural programs in the assembly hall. Thank you.
Secular India. see the unity and diversity of India. We have next a glimpse of one of the most culturally excellent parts of India. A fusion dance that brings to you the talent of RIEM as well as the different cultural dances of South India.
Thank you.
our institutions of our region.
Thank you.
performance.
Thank you. be seated. Please don't leave the hall. Up to one and all, I am privileged to stand before the gathering to propose vote of thanks at this time to the Honorable for 50 Smith Foundation Day celebrations of NCERT. As it is rightly said, all good things have to stop at some point. In spite of very busy schedule and official commitments, Dr. R.S. Praveen Kumar sir accepted our invitation and raised question. Sir, your law of thinking and suggestions as an administrator will be taken in future course of action in implementing learning outcomes. Our students are very excited about for systemic accountability. They have been crowding you when you were taking tea. Thank you once again, sir, on behalf of the principal and my personal behalf. Dr. Nagaraj, sir, we are very happy to have you in the program. As you have rightly said, education is to ensure child to survive and live a dignified life in the world. Your suggestion that school as a unit to be compared not as a child is apt for systemic accountability. Thank you, sir, for joining the panel discussion. Sundar Raman sir, thank you for your valuable suggestion, especially in implementing mother tongue as compulsory subject for improved learning outcomes. Professor Y. Srikant sir, conceived the idea of having panel discussion of students' learning outcomes, which is very apt in the present scenario of education. As you suggested, the policymakers need to think of licensing exams for teachers at all levels. Thank you, sir, for giving the faculty a chance to listen and understand the domains otherwise not known to us. I wish to thank Professor Rama Madam, Dean Academic, for gracing the occasion. I also thank Dr. Doswami, sir, for accepting the invitation and attending the program. I also thank all my colleagues who have taken their time off in spite of their classes and attended the program. Not least, I think the program is successful by the teamwork of various committees. I thank on behalf of principal and as a committee coordinator, I wish to thank Dr. V. Prasad, Dr. Suresh Kumar, Dr. Sarvesh Maurya, Mr. Rohit of Physics, 11th Sem, Dr. T. V. Somshekar, Dr. Sujata, Dr. Nagar, Zoology Section, Dr. Professor B. Ramadas, Mr. Gulab Singh, Mr. Santosh Kumar, Mr. Salman of 11th Sem Physics, Dr. V. Prasad, Dr. P. R. Harna, Dr. Jyoti, Professor Hilda G. Nair, Mr. Pawan Kumar, Cultural Secretary, Mr. Reshma Sani, Cultural Secretary, and Sujata and V. Sampu, especially morning, helped me a lot, and Santosh Kumar Rao and Dr. Nagaraj for his valuable suggestions. A special thanks to Professor Kalpana and her team for helping us from the DEE section. Not last but least. Mr. Simhavati, who helped me to coordinate my work. I extend my thanks to all my students who were very eager to help me. Thanks to the Audio Visual Studio and Rajendra for recording the program. I also thank Mr. Janardhan sir for helping me to get the dresses and also organizing the skit program, which went off very well. May I now request the gathering to stand for national anthem.